Our sense of place involves more than just the built environment. It factors in social assets related to history, identity, and people. With community-based participation and trust building at its center, placemaking creates spaces of gathering to learn, exchange, and heal. Focusing on Flint, Chicago, and Richmond, we will explore artistic and cultural spaces that embody healing and reconciliation. A drive down bumpy, brick-paved Saginaw Street is a jarring trip back in time, to before the Flint water crisis, before the plant closings and the crime, unemployment, abandonment, before white flight, before, when Flint was known for its cars or its carriages, before it was known for everything else. The city of Flint, Michigan once boasted one of the highest per capita incomes of any city in the country. It was the birthplace of General Motors, the home of the middle class, and the promise of the American dream. Now, with a population of just under 100,000, down from nearly 200,000 in the 1960s, and GM employment down from 80,000 to 8,000, Flint suffered a total systems collapse. A dwindling tax base led to infrastructure overcapacity, a loss of city services, culminating in record crime, and the moniker the most dangerous city, and more recently, lead-tainted water. The Flint Public Art Project, begun in 2015, seeks to reclaim the narrative for Flint residents who, despite many hardships, are resilient, loyal, and hopeful for the city's future. The Flint Public Art Project began at the height of the Flint water crisis as a way to combat the negative attention Flint was receiving from all over the world. Despite every challenge and man-made disaster for the residents who had endured post-industrial ills for decades, having Flint defined for them by outsiders was simply adding insult to injury. With a surplus of abandoned buildings and urban blight, one of the greatest challenges to Flint's image was its looks. Joe Scipani, executive director of the nonprofit Flint Public Art Project, set out to change that. Last year alone, the project installed over 100 public murals around the city, attracting artists from 27 countries, along with dozens of local artists. With the ongoing pandemic this year, Joe says they've gotten a late start. Only 25 or 30 will be finished before the snow flies. In an interview with Joe Scipani, he told me his concept originated with the problem of out-of-town photojournalists coming to document Flint's decay in what's sometimes referred to as ruin porn. Placing art on street corners, abandoned buildings, and businesses intentionally spoiled the picture of despair and decay, and flipped the narrative, in Joe's words, from blight to beauty. The murals come in all sizes, some on prominent street corners downtown, others on empty stretches of Flint's shrinking neighborhoods. Some of them are topical, some address the many challenges Flint has faced and continues to face, including crime, racism, water, unemployment. Others exist simply for beauty's sake. There are memorials, dedications, and political exhortations. Some are nostalgic, while others express Flint's signature gallows humor. But Flint's history is everywhere. Often the murals tell you where you are. Here on the east side, Flint's historically Hispanic neighborhoods are home to depictions of Frida Kahlo and the history of Hispanic immigrants in Flint. And a recently completed addition called Border Wall. One of Flint's oldest sites of public art, known simply as The Rock, has been the site of memorials, birthday wishes, congratulatory messages, and simply a part of Flint's culture for over four decades. So popular, it's repainted with a new message almost daily. Taken together, Flint's art serves to make the city a place people call home, a place they recognize as their own. Public art in Flint crosses racial and economic boundaries and speaks to the incredible challenges and the history the city's faced together over decades. By telling its own story, Flint reclaims its voice, and its message is proud, strong, and hopeful. Through the outlet of public art, Flint's trauma and its ongoing struggles are transformed. In redefining its shared places through art, it's turning struggle into meaning and healing for the city.
There's a mural in Chicago that isn't made up with paint and brushes. It's made up of names. Names all too familiar. These are just some of the names of Black Americans killed by police officers. While the names and identities of these people don't all cross paths with Chicago, there's a reason why a mural like this ended up in this particular neighborhood, in this particular city. Chicago is an exemplary city in many areas. When it comes to music, Chicago artists made profound contributions to jazz, blues, and hip-hop. For sports, it's the home of Michael Jordan and the 85 Bears. But Chicago is also exemplary in another area, segregation. No matter how you try to break it down, Chicago ranks near the top of every list of segregated cities. That's because there's not one unified Chicago, but several radically different Chicago experiences. Chicago has the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. Looking at a map of racial demographics, we see neatly sorted dots. And if these dots look like they've been placed there deliberately, it's because they had been. Throughout the 20th century, Chicago's neighborhoods were transformed by a process known as redlining. Any neighborhood that was uniformly white would get marked green or blue, and properties there were more likely to be approved for loans and insurance. The more Black and brown people in a neighborhood, the more likely it was to be marked yellow or red, which meant the properties in the area were far less likely to be approved. While the official practice of redlining has ended, we still see the ramifications of it today, looking at hyper-segregation, violence, and spending on incarceration. Rogers Park, the neighborhood where this Black Lives mural lives, was built on redlining too. The area was marked yellow because, according to the Homeowners Loan Corporation, in spite of the fact that the section had excellent transportation, very good shopping facilities, and was conveniently located in terms of the beach, the fact was that it was 80% Jewish, and that quote-unquote limited its appeal to people other than this class of resident. Its yellow marking made it available for minorities to move in, and the white people that did live there weren't always welcome everywhere else. Now it is one of the most racially integrated neighborhoods in the city, with nearly equal representation between white people, Black people, and Latinos. The P.O. Box Collective, a group of activist artists in Chicago, wanted to create a space for the neighborhood to let out their collective feelings about Black deaths at the hands of Chicago police officers. Under the CTA's Red Line, which is the name of a train, they've created a public mural dedicated to the lives lost due to police brutality. Every Sunday, they invite people to take a card and write a new name on the wall, shining a light on that new story. They say it's more than a mural, it's a community altar. The location of this project was very purposeful, as it's just across the street and shares the same tunnel with another famous mural. The city failed to protect these Black lives, but their spirits are now watched over by the sacred guardians of human consciousness, a long row of multicolored beings. These guardians have been there since 2012, when international graffiti artist Mira One made it as part of the neighborhood's Mile of Murals project. When describing his work, Mira One said, "This mural represents what was, is, and could be our human potential. No one person is limited by him or herself, nor by each other. Rather, by connection to one another and to a larger sense of community, human potential becomes limitless as our own consciousness awakens to the knowledge that we are all custodians of the world, sharing in the gift of being and being as one."
His name is Marcus David Peters. He lived in Richmond, Virginia. He was known for his corny jokes. He was close to his family and was adored by his nieces and nephews. On May 14, 2018, he left his day job teaching high school biology and life skills and arrived at his second job at the Jefferson Hotel, where he worked as a part-time security guard. There he experienced a mental health episode. Still in crisis, he left the hotel naked and unarmed. He got into his car and while driving, he veered off the side of a highway. A police officer who was called to the scene saw Marcus climb out, disoriented. The officer attempted to subdue him with his taser. When Marcus advanced, the officer fired two shots in his abdomen, killing him. He was only 24. In June 2020, as an act of remembering and reclamation, local light projection artist Dustin Klein cast Marcus's photo onto the controversial monument of Confederate General Robert E. Lee. To begin to understand how we arrived at this moment, we need to talk about Richmond's past. Richmond, a former capital of the Confederacy, burned 155 years ago. The Confederacy knew it was losing the Civil War, So to protect their assets from Union seizure, they ordered their soldiers to set fire to this bridge and supply warehouses. The Confederacy retreated as all of Richmond went up in flames. With the flames long extinguished and the city rebuilt, Richmond still enshrined the white Southern Lost Cause narrative, asserting the nobility of the Confederate cause as morally just. Decades after the Civil War, monuments of Confederate leaders started to populate streets, parks, and public spaces as a form of worship used to explain their defeat and to intimidate. The largest monument is of Robert E. Lee, which looms over Richmond's historic Monument Ave and its large, expensive homes. Just blocks away from Lee's statue is a direct response to these Confederate symbols of hate and white supremacy. Last year, the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts commissioned a sculpture by artist Kehinde Wiley. The statue, called Rumors of War, isn't of a general. It's a young Black man with Air Jordans and ripped jeans. He sits on the horse with determination. He is heroic. The piece's name comes from a passage in the Bible, Matthew chapter 24, verse 6. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. What has come is over 60 days of nightly protests in Richmond, which started shortly after the murder of George Floyd. Protesters have contextualized monuments and have toppled others. Some monuments have been taken down by the city. Lee's statue still remains, but has been contextualized. What was built as an oversized traffic circle to anchor an all-white neighborhood has now become home to daily peacemaking circles. Renamed the Marcus David Peters Circle, the area surrounding the monument is now reclaimed as a site for truth and reconciliation. The community planted a garden and installed basketball hoops. A radical free library was erected with books from Black and Brown writers. Signs and memorials with the message "Say Their Names" circle the monument. Every day, cross-cultural groups of people, Black, white, Latinx, Asian Americans, congregate together. They are of all ages. A wheelchair ramp was installed for accessibility. This level of interconnectedness embodies healing and unity in the midst of so much pain. In June, two local female artists, Neil Cathcart and Austin Oz Miles, drew inspiration from the contextualized monuments. They too have a response to the Lee statue. Their mural, called A Time to Rise, centers a mother and her child mounted on a leaping horse, surrounded by the names of Brianna and Tamir, and the words of Black Lives Matter, Hands Up, Justice. The mother and child are two generations charging towards truth and accountability. The piece calls for change and perseverance. It's about reclaiming what once held us down, said Oz, while uplifting and guiding the city towards peace and repair. On July 25th, the Legba Folklore Society led a reclamation drum circle to honor what would have been Emmett Till's 79th birthday. It was an open call for anyone in the community to come out to drum, sing, and move. People shared their instruments and seats. They passed water bottles around to make sure everyone stayed hydrated. There was dedicated time for people to share their stories and to listen to words of others. In a city wounded by generational trauma, Marcus David Peters Circle has transformed into a space of empathy and solidarity. It is still painful, and it is also inspiring and hopeful.
Thank you.